So let me parallel two illnesses for you, Gulf War illness and chronic fatigue syndrome. Gulf War was in 1991, right? So there's a war. A whole bunch of people came home sick, about a third. Right. Stayed sick, mostly men, because mostly men went there. And they were veterans. They had served their country. The Congress was committed to trying to do something about this. The budget for Gulf War illness in an average year, somewhere around $35 million a year, 40 in a big year, for the roughly 250,000 ill veterans, and they deserve every nickel of that. Absolutely, yeah. It should be done. But if you can see that that investment has moved us to the point of 22 clinical trials.
In Gulf War.
In Gulf War illness, right? With that level of investment. So where are we in ME-CFS? You know, you're looking at this thing and you're saying, all right, our NIH RFA is nice. It's all about pathogenesis and what are the underpinnings. And yeah, you need to know that stuff to design clinical trials. But where is the mechanism to do a clinical trial? I mean, we have been in Gulf War illness. We started doing the systems biology later than the work that we were doing in ME-CFS. I'm in clinical trial.
Yes.
Okay, and we're pushing homeostasis. I went from a virtual clinical trials to cell-based models to animal models. We cured a bunch of mice. We're in
human.
We're in human. Right. I mean, we're in it. We're there. Done. We're there. Mm-hmm. And we're in our first phase one study. How exciting. How long did that take? About 8 years. Right. About 8 years ago, I had my first systems biology data in ME-CFS. I was ready to start doing this modeling then. And, you know, we've done a lot of work. It's not that we've been idle, but we've done it, you know, smoke and mirrors and relatively small funds. But we are in the ME-CFS world. We have the models. We know what to do. We're ready for human clinical trial. I should have been there first.
Right. And but the lack of investment.
There's no place to go.
Is what
I mean, because this was, it was so frustrating because with the VA and with the DOD, I mean, the DOD in particular, it's a mechanism, congressionally directed medical research, phenomenal mechanism because they can spin on a dime. They change the direction of what their portfolio is looking like every single year. They redo their whole thing. Okay, this is what we learned this year. What do we do with that knowledge that makes the, and the focus, laser focus, get these guys better, you know.
Yeah, more nimble.
Move it to clinical trial. Yeah. Move it.
Yeah,
you know, fascinating work, but we're not doing crazy hypothetical weirdness stuff here. We want stuff that's going to help these vets. Absolutely. And I love that. It's a really nice way to handle a portfolio. What happened was kind of serendipity. We were working also in an illness, Gulf War illness, very similar then to ME-CFS. And but much better funded, and we were doing this work with many different universities, and we'd written this great big grant. It's called a consortia grant that the Department of Defense was offering, and we were awarded this grant. And we, instead of actually doing the work at separate universities, the key players moved to this university to start this infrastructure of this brand new collaborative team.
And you have pioneered in the group also, kind of, you are the early one who did system biology approach to the entire, holistically entire fields of medicine and ME-CFS and Gulf War syndrome too, but
it's
in ME-CFS, integrating bioinformatics analysis and modeling with translational science as well as basic science.
In our group, you know, I get all the credit. I mean, remember, I couldn't do computational biology. I know how to talk to computational biologists, and I'm so in awe of what they do. And the team that we have, you know, Dr. Broderick and Dr. Craddock, Travis Craddock and Gordon Broderick, they're just brilliant.
Super,
you know,
absolutely.
Crazy smart. And so if the Gulf War phase one study is also promising, I feel like the trainer wheels are off and let's just get going. You know, this is so exciting.
That's great.
So, I'm very enthusiastic about that. I dare say that this Gulf War trial that we're just launching right now will be done in about a year. Will be our proving ground.
Wonderful.
You know? So let's hope
Wonderful.
That it's as good as we hope it should be.
And can ME-CFS arms be added to that trial?
Absolutely. Like, for instance, in our Gulf War illness trial that we launched, it's in a subgroup. It's in men because men and women are wired so differently that the models fly out very differently. And then it's in a group with more adrenal stress pattern than the other group. So it's sort of like the high-stress men group is this model. But we have a model for low-stress men. We have a model for high-stress women and low-stress women. Postmenopausal, premenopausal, we can really play the model. Yeah. So it starts looking personalized.
Yeah.
But in truth, they are subgroups. We're comparing two illnesses, Gulf War and chronic fatigue syndrome. They have very similar presentations, and they're equally complex. Many of you may not know about Gulf War illness. We're talking about the first Gulf War in 1991. It was a very short war, about 6 weeks long. But the veterans of that war had a tremendous amount of toxin exposures, particularly neurotoxins. And roughly one in three is still sick today, disabling, ill. Anyway, this is very interesting what you hash out. First Gulf War and chronic fatigue syndrome, as much as I am a clinician that has seen hundreds of Gulf War patients and many, many thousands of chronic fatigue patients, they aren't clinically different. You can't tell them apart. There's nothing about them that you could clinically tell them apart. But genomically, and after an exercise challenge where you really ramp up the signal, boy, are they different, you know? Though they have some sameness. So what's first is interesting is in the case of ME-CFS, what you see is a tremendous decrement in metabolic pathways when you do this kind of exercise challenge. Whereas with Gulf War, you see a tremendous upregulation of alternate signaling pathways. So they're trying to get past it. If you map, network map, this is when you say, okay, there's this gene path and this gene path. Are they talking to each other? And how many genes do I have to work through? How many pathways do I have to work through before these two are communicating with each other? So this is really cool because it takes in what's working correctly as well as what's working incorrectly into the analysis. And when you see a normal person, you see a spider web of communication. Average link 10, average number of pathways 3. So it's like, yeah, you can sort of see through that, right? With Gulf War, there's so many pathways engaged, you can't even look at it, right? You can't see through that. It's a huge number of upregulated pathways. Chronic fatigue syndrome, there's no talking. Everything's shut down. There's no communication between anybody. So big surprise that instead of seeing with inflammation upregulated, that the anti-inflammatory pathways should then upregulate, they fail. You don't get a cortisol bump after inflammation. It turns off, it doesn't turn on. So this is like opposite land, right? They aren't the same, but they present very similarly. Is any biomarker a good biomarker for diagnostics? And you take a classic rock curve like you see there on the right. This is NK cell function. And in fact, it's a darn good biomarker. Red is Gulf War, white is chronic fatigue syndrome. So you see Gulf War patients have even more impaired NK cell dysfunction. But you can look at many different types of things. And this is looking at cytokine panels above and below the line. And if you look at things that are elevated, red is chronic fatigue syndrome, versus things that are deficient. It's interesting, what's deficient are the things that would improve NK cell function if they were normal, and things that are anti-inflammatory or chemotaxis. And the things that are elevated are neuroinflammatory and Th2 regulatory cytokines. So we get back to what we're doing. We're saying, okay, in healthy people, here's the endocrine system, the immune system, the autonomic nervous system, all the neuropeptides, all playing together. I have a cold right now, so I'm not right there. I'm like right here. But when I'm done, I would hope I would bounce back to my old spot. But if you had something happen that brought you up over the mountain and dropped you into this new spot, this is your balance. And you can't go back here. It's not a straight line. You have to climb the mountain to get back. And so when we do the mathematical modeling of how to get back, it's never a straight line. It's all about how do you perturbate the system enough it has to find a new steady state. And then how do you shove it in the steady state way that drives it back? So this is one such study. This isn't Gulf War illness. I say that because we're really far along. Let's just say we're really well funded in Gulf War illness. And we have been able to take the virtual modeling through both cell models and animal models all the way to human clinical trial because we had the funding mechanisms to do that. And this is what basically what the in silico thing said was in Gulf War illness, if you could block the pro-inflammatory cytokine cascade long enough to reduce neuroinflammation, and then block the HPA access long enough to force it to do an internal reboot, reset, that you could, if you did it in that time course, one and then two, hypothetically reboot the whole system back to normal. sounded crazy. But in golf war illness, we have an animal model that's darn good. We took our dynamic modeling model, and we looked at all the animal models that are out there for golf war illness. And we actually had people do exercise challenges on the animals and do the dynamic modeling in the animals and found the best fit. And we picked that model as our testing model. And then we aged that animal out after we induced the illness, the equivalent of 10 years of illness. And then we did this. And we rebooted, we brought neuroinflammation down about 50%, which was enough. And then we threw the mifepristone dose in there, and a single dose of mifepristone, and we rebooted those animals back to normal. Their autonomic function normalized, their immune function normalized, their neuroendocrine balance all normalized, and we can challenge these animals and get normal dynamic models out of them. So we are over the moon that our very first best model. And let me tell you that when I say the first model, you run 20,000 clinical trials in silico before you come up with the best model. But when we took the best of those many clinical trials and we put it into an animal model, we were successful. And now we are funded by the DOD to do that in human. And it's through the IRB. It's back in the DOD human subjects office right now, waiting for the final approval. And we will be running this clinical trial before Christmas.